When it comes to race, we've overcome quite a lot in this country. Slavery. Civil War. Segregation. We've even elected a black man to the highest office in the land.
Change has come to America.
But as tempting as it might be to celebrate these things as signs that we've entered into a period of colorblind post-racial harmony,
we have to admit that we're moving forward in this world and that race issues are moving to the periphery.
I think those problems are largely behind us.
The fact is, racial inequalities still exist.
Today, there are more African Americans in prison or jail on probation or parole than were enslaved in 1850, a decade before the Civil War began.
And racial bias still affects the way we view others.
I want you to check out this protester. See the sign he's waving there? It's the president made to look like an African witch doctor.
And when we fail to recognize that, we not only continue to do an injustice to people of color, we end up doing damage to white folks as well. I'm Tim Wise, an anti-racist educator and author. I grew up in the South in Nashville, Tennessee, and at a very early age, I figured out that race mattered. My parents were educated in a completely segregated environment, and wanting me to have a different experience than they had had, they decided to send me to a preschool program at Tennessee State University, a historically black college. In a class of about 20 kids, I was one of only three students who weren't black. The teachers, the staff, the administrators there were also mostly African American. And this meant that from a very young age, I learned to respect black authority figures in a way that many of my white peers probably wouldn't have. And this seemingly minor detail made a huge difference in how I came to see the world.
Joining us now is Tim Wise, an educator, anti-racist advocate, and the author of White Like Me, Reflections on Race from a Privileged Son.
For more than 20 years now, I've been trying to better understand for myself and to raise awareness, among others, about the centrality of race and racism to the history of this country, and how dangerous and damaging it is when white people, like me, are blind to racial inequality and our own privileges.
Because if you know the history of the whole concept of whiteness, if you know the history of the whole concept of the white race, where it came from and for what reason, you know that it was a trick, and it's worked brilliantly. See, prior to the mid to late 1600s in the colonies of what would become the United States, there was no such thing as the white race. Those of us of European descent did not refer to ourselves by that term really ever before then. In fact, in the old countries of Europe, we had spent most of our time killing each other. We didn't love each other. We weren't one big happy family. The side of my family that comes from Scotland, hell, they didn't even worry about fighting people outside of Scotland. Highlanders and Lowlanders just fought the hell out of each other. So there was no white race, but in the colonies of what would become the United States, what did we see in the 1660s, 1670s? We began to see that Africans of indentured servant status, many of them not enslaved yet, they were not necessarily permanently enslaved. Some were, others were indentured like many poor Europeans for periods of 7 to 11 years. They could work off their indenture and then they would be free labor technically. Realized, as did the white indentured servants, the Europeans who hadn't even been called white yet, that they had a lot of things in common, like the fact that they were all getting their clock cleaned by the elite. And so they would get together more than our history books taught us to foment rebellion against the elite, to try to get a better deal for themselves on the basis of economic necessity and economic justice. And what did the elite do? When you see that you're outnumbered by black and white folks who are penniless, landless, peasants, you have to do one of two things. You either have to kill them all, but you can't do that because who's going to work? Rich folks weren't going to. They had to get poor people to work. The whole point was to be a person of leisure back in those days. That was the goal, was not to work. So you couldn't kill them all. You didn't want to kill them all. You had to do the work yourself. You had to build your own levee, build your own house. No, pick your own tobacco, harvest your own cotton. No, we're not going to do any of that. So you can't kill them, but you can co-opt them. And so the elite in Virginia, for example, in the colony, begins to give certain carrots to people of European descent saying things like, you know, we're going to let you own a little land, not much, but just a little. And we're going to get rid of indentured servitude. Now you're free labor. And by the way, once you're free labor, you get 50 acres of land. Just because you're free labor, see? So we're going to cut you in on this deal. We're going to let you enter into contracts. We're going to let you testify in court. And here's the best of all. We're going to put you on the slave patrol to keep those people in line, right? The idea was, you're still going to get your clock clean. We still don't like you. We still aren't going to really empower you or change your economic subordination. But we're going to make you honorary members of this team, and you're going to help us keep those other people down. And so they got a little taste of power, and it did effectively divide and conquer those coalitions. Those rebellions began to stop almost instantly. Fast forward to the Civil War era, you have rich white folks in the South, where I come from, standing up and openly admitting that the reason they're prepared to secede from the Union, and the only reason they ever articulated publicly, ever, was to maintain and extend slavery and white supremacy not only where it already existed, but into the newly acquired, that is to say, stolen territories from Mexico to the West. That was what they said. Now we lie about it. We say it wasn't about slavery, that it was about states' rights. Yes, the right of the states to keep and maintain slaves, exactly. But back then they had no shame, so they didn't try and cover it up. They openly said it, but once again, the rich didn't want to go do the work. Are you kidding? No. They're going to get poor people to go fight for them. And the poor folks didn't even own slaves. Now think, how do you get poor people who don't even own the shirt on their back, let alone slaves, to go fight to keep your slaves for you? You've got to convince them that their skin is more important than their economic interest. Because think about it, if I am a farmer who has to charge you $1 a day or $2 a week to work on your farm and harvest that tobacco or pick that cotton, but you can get a black person to do it for free because you own them, who's going to get the job? Not me. In other words, slavery actually undermined the wages and the wage base, the economic floor of the typical white working class or low-income person. But they were told, if these people are freed, they're going to take your job. No, fool, they got your job. That's the point. And so at some level, again, working class white people being harmed by white privilege, relatively being advantaged, right? Being given a leg up, being given a membership to the club, but in absolute terms being kept economically subordinated by the very thing that gave them a sense of superiority. How's that for irony? Then in the present era, this hasn't stopped. This is not ancient history. Now we have people running around insisting that we should close the border with Mexico because if we don't, the wages of working class people will continue to fall, the implication being that the only reason workers are paid like crap in this country is because the border is open. It isn't going to be closed to goods. If you have a border that can be crossed by capital looking for the highest return on investment or goods looking for the highest price, but labor is chained to its country of origin, how is that going to work to the benefit of working people? By definition, it doesn't. By definition, it immiserates the working class. Divide and conquer. But the best example of all, perhaps, in the contemporary era, in the greater New Orleans area after Katrina, here you have two communities that were the most hard hit. The Lower Ninth Ward, mostly black community, 94% African American, about 40% official poverty rate, heavy working class community. And right across the canal, St. Bernard Parish, Chalmette, 95% white, also working class, high levels of poverty, economically very similar. And at the end of the day, in those first few days of September 2005, more similar than they probably would have realized. Because when those levees broke, they all got their stuff jacked. They all got their stuff destroyed. But if you had asked white folks in Chalmette, and I've done it, who was the cause of the problems in the greater New Orleans area prior to that flooding, they would have pointed across that canal at those black folks, wouldn't have called them black folks, and would have said, there, that's the problem. 70% of the white folks in St. Bernard Parish voted for David Duke, white supremacist, neo-Nazi, former head of the largest Ku Klux Klan group in the United States when he ran for governor in 1991. 7 out of 10 gladly voted for him because he was blaming black folks for all of their problems, and they bought it. What's the irony? The irony is that while they were blaming black people for their problems, while they were blaming black people for the conditions of the greater New Orleans area in which they lived, nobody was paying attention, least of all they, to the fact that these white elite politicians, either in Baton Rouge or in Washington, whose job it was to secure those levees, to make sure that levee funds were spent in the proper way and that they were spent at all, those mostly white and mostly elite politicians did nothing. At the end of the day, it wasn't just the black folks in the lower ninth ward they didn't care about. They really couldn't have given a rat's ass about those poor and working class white folks either. And yet, when the people of Chalmette, people of St. Bernard Parish got back into session, first time they had a city council meeting, parish council meeting after the flooding, the lights aren't even on yet. The water isn't even hooked up. And the first order of business was to pass an ordinance saying that you couldn't rent property in St. Bernard Parish to anyone who wasn't a blood relative. Now, I'll leave it to your imagination as to why you'd want to pass a law. That law had never existed before. But now that it's been emptied out and you don't know who might come back, that's a damn good way to keep black people out, isn't it? Because if you're 95% white to begin with, if you pass an ordinance that says that, that's a great, you can't say no blacks need apply. You can't say no blacks allowed, but that was an ingenious way to get around the law. Now, they got caught. There was a lawsuit threatened, and they got rid of the ordinance. But my point in bringing it up is to say, once again, divide and conquer is working. These white folks in Chalmette need to march across that canal and join hands with the black folks who've been sitting there more than willing to work with them for an awful long time and march on Baton Rouge and march on D.C. and march on the Corps of Engineers and recognize their commonality of interest. But the whiteness and the lure of whiteness has tricked these have nothing in their bank account white people into believing that they got more in common with the rich white folks on St. Charles Avenue that didn't lose anything in that flooding than they have in common with the black working class folks who live about 500 yards away.
In the book and in the movie version a couple of years later, Griffin, a white man, tells the story of how he darkened his skin with dye, medicine, and intense UV rays in order to experience what it was like for African Americans in the pre-Civil Rights South of the 1950s. Over the course of 6 weeks, Griffin recounts how he was harassed, followed, and threatened by racist whites.
You better find yourself another place to sit.
And in the end, he says that his assumption blacks were treated like second-class citizens turned out to be wrong. It was closer to 10th class.
You know what we do to troublemakers here?
No.
We kill a nigger and toss him one of these swamps, nobody ever know anything about it.
The book became a bestseller and a sensation, and it had a profound impact on me and countless other high schoolers. Toward the very beginning of the book, Griffin asks, how else, except by becoming a Negro, could a white man hope to learn the truth, ultimately concluding that the best way to find out if we had second-class citizens and what their plight was would be to become one of them.
White Southerner has to know what it's like to be a Negro.
Instead of asking what it's like to be black, what if we just asked what it's like to be white?
I don't really know how, what it means really to be white or what it's supposed to mean.
I guess I never really thought about it, but it was always kind of a negative thing.
When I ask students what it means to be white, what I hear from them is a lot of confusion.
The question, what does it mean to be white, it baffles my mind. I don't know what it means.
Like, whiteness isn't something we think much about, and in some ways, that makes perfect sense.
In terms of white culture, it's very general and very vague. Like, I think, like, sitting down and having dinner with my family. But all cultures do that.
Because when you're part of a dominant group, you're not forced to spend a lot of time thinking about how you fit in or about how your privileges as a member of the dominant group might affect others who don't belong to it.
In order to express ourselves, we don't have to fit into black culture, Hispanic culture, Asian American culture. We can just kind of do what we want. And I'm not sure if that's a good thing or a bad thing. It's just...
There's no denying that white people in the U.S. have had privileges throughout history that people of color simply haven't. Consider the very first law passed by Congress after ratifying the Constitution, the Naturalization Act of 1790, which said that free white persons and only free white persons could become full citizens of this country. Basically, our very first law as a constitutional republic gave white immigrants privileges that black people and immigrants of color and indigenous native North Americans weren't given, all of it based purely on skin color. And whether we want to acknowledge it or not, this kind of systematic white privilege and race-based favoritism is built into the very foundations of the country.
I read a paper where somebody was listing an experience where it was a group of females talking about, you know, what it's like to be a woman. And there was a white woman talking to a black woman saying, you know, well, we have similar experiences because we're both women. And the black woman looks at her and says, no, we don't. And she goes, well, yeah, but we're both women. And the black woman says, no, because when you look in the mirror, you're a woman. When I look in the mirror, I'm a black woman. So it's that thing that you have to, it's that thing that you don't notice.
For myself, from the very beginning, I was seen as a bright and capable child, and I was tracked into the higher level classes. If I didn't do well, I never had to worry that it would be ascribed to my race, that someone might say, well, of course he didn't do really very well on the SAT because, you know, he is white. And this isn't just an anecdotal one-off story. The fact is there are 20 to 25 years of research. Studies which have found that students of color all around the country are worried about confirming negative stereotypes in the classroom. Any fear that somehow they might live down to a negative group stigma directly affects their performance on tests. That's something that I, as a white student, didn't have to worry about. And so we live with the legacy of inequality that began so long ago, but also the legacy of obliviousness that allows those of us in the dominant group to rarely even think about these matters. And even with all the changes and the progress we have seen, that is something that hasn't changed.
Well, it's me. I'm back again here to talk about fear, pride, arrogance, narcissism, all that good stuff. So what is it that stops so many white people from wanting to change their hearts in regards to race and wanting to see the reality and come out of denial? What is it that keeps us stuck right there in that comfortable position of untruth? Well, I think part of it is fear. Another part of it is greed. Greed in that we don't want to lose dominance, we don't want to lose power, we don't want to lose privileges, we don't want to lose benefits that the system of white supremacy has created here in America for white people. We don't want to lose none of it. We're scared. We're scared of black retribution, we're scared of black vengeance. We're scared shitless, and we always have been. Since day one, we put our hands on black people. Grabbed them, snatched them up, put them on a boat, and made them our own fucking personal slaves and assistants for no pay. We did all that. You goddamn right we're scared. We're scared of losing what we got. We're scared of losing our positions. And we're scared of retribution. So we got a lot of fucking fear, man. Yeah, we do. You hear me, white brothers and sisters? A lot of fucking fear. We're scared. We always have been. You see a black man walk down the street, you lock your doors, you check, make sure he ain't gonna hurt you, you clutch your purse. We're scared. So what we do? Lock them up, throw them in jail. World's largest prison population of black folks right now. It's right here in this fucking country. I wonder why. We're fucking scared. Even the fucking police officers, the coward police officers that kill unarmed black people are scared. We're scared of that retribution, scared of that black vengeance. And then we project, and then we pretend and project that black people are as racist as white people. Who the fuck ever taught a black person black supremacy? The first thing a fucking black person learns is why it's wrong to be a supremacist. They deal with that shit their whole fucking life. Why the fuck would they want them to act supreme? I ain't never heard a black person go around acting superior because of the color of their skin. If anything, they do the opposite. It's white people that are taught. I ain't saying black people can't hate. I ain't saying black people can't be angry. But hell, if they do hate, it's a hate that hate produced. It's a anger that anger produced from white supremacy, a culture, and a system of white supremacy. So yeah, black people are angry. Some of them, not all of them, some of them. The point is, face your fear, face your greed, so that we can fucking have a more peaceful country, a more peaceful world, until white people face that greed that they have. Oh, I got to be on top. I got to keep my white privilege. Oh, God, I'm scared that the black people going to kill me. They going to come get me. They going to snatch me up the way we did them. They going to do all that dirty shit to me that white people have done to them. Stop being so fucking scared, man. Man up, woman up. Let's face reality. White supremacy is real. Our country is a country of white fucking supremacy. Yes, sir, it is. It always has been. Let's face it. Let's do something about it. Let's take some fucking responsibility. Act up, speak up, vote. Do what you got to do. Be active. Protest. Get in the fucking streets. White people have to change their fucking culture of white supremacy. If we don't, it will destroy us all, and it already is. All of us. Has to do with morality. This thing about getting out of denial. One, you got to acknowledge the truth. We are a white supremacist nation, and we always have been. We have white supremacist institutions, culture, structures, power, psychology. Everything. Politics. Whitewashing is in everything. The media, the education. History is whitewashed and biased. Education is whitewashed and biased. Entertainment is whitewashed and biased. I ain't saying black people are bad. We're all equal. We know this. Our culture's racist. Our white culture's racist. I ain't saying all white people are racist. I'm not saying that. But it's all that indifference. It's all that inaction. It's all that turning a blind fucking eye. That's the real fucking problem. Step up. Get out of indifference. Do something. Say something. I'm not proud of white America anymore. I used to be a fucking racist. Not proud of America anymore. Face your fear and face your greed, once and for all. Take your fucking country back to what it should be, which is means it's made for all people, not just white people. Bye.
Welcome back to Face the Nation. With us now is former New York City Mayor Rudy Giuliani. Mr. Mayor, I want to ask you about something former Speaker Newt Gingrich said, which is that he said white Americans can't understand the extra risk that comes with being black in America, and that whites instinctively underestimate the danger of the black experience. What do you think about that?
The reality is we have to look differently at race in America if we're going to change this. Whites have to realize that African-American men have a fear, and boys have a fear of being confronted by the police because of some of these incidents. Some people may consider it rational, some people may consider it irrational, but it's a reality. It exists. On the black side, you've got to teach your children to be respectful to the police, and you've got to teach your children that the real danger to them is not the police. The real danger to them, 99 out of 100 times, 9,900 out of 1,000 times, are other black kids who are going to kill them. That's the way they're going to die.
Mr. Mayor, let me just ask you. You started off by saying that white Americans have to understand that this is happening in the black community, and then at the end, you said members of the black community have to teach their children to behave in front of the police, that those messages seem to conflict with one another.
Of course they don't. If I were a black father and I was concerned about the safety of my child, really concerned about it, and not in a politically activist sense, I would say be very respectful to police. Most of them are good. Some can be very bad. And just be very careful.
And so what do police...
I'd also say... be very careful of those kids in the neighborhood and don't get involved with them because, son, there's a 99% chance they're going to kill you, not the police.
We never talked about race growing up. I just don't think that was ever a conversation.
I thought that love would conquer all and skin color really didn't matter. I had to learn the really hard way when they almost killed you.
Yeah. I was 19 years old. I had picked up a friend and I noticed that we had red and blue lights behind us. We were being pulled over. The officer explained I had made an illegal left turn and to step out of the car. So I get out of the car first. He pats me down and then he goes around to the passenger side and pulls my friend Addison out of the car.
Addison is white.
Yeah, Addison is white. And he had some weed in his coat pocket. So he gets placed in handcuffs. I figure that everything's okay. I'm not in handcuffs. I've already been patted down. Plus, there's three officers on the scene. And I had never had a negative interaction with police in my life. So I ask them, can I please see a warrant before you continue the search? And they grab me and begin to hit me in the face. I could hear Addison in the background yelling, stop, leave him alone. I was hit several times, and I remember gasping for air and spitting and blood flying across the grass. And then I hear an officer shout out, he's reaching for a gun. I immediately started yelling, no, I'm not. I'm not reaching for anything. And I remember an officer say, if he doesn't calm down, we're going to have to shoot him. I could feel the gun pressed to my head. I expected to be shot. And at that point, I lost consciousness. I woke up to a multitude of officers just standing around me laughing. One officer was like, where's that warrant now, you fucking nigger? It took 45 stitches to close up the lacerations in my face alone. How did it feel when you finally saw me?
All I remember is involuntarily screaming.
That was the first time I had cried the entire time I had been in there. And it wasn't my injuries that hurt. It was just seeing how it devastated you.
My whole worldview changed that night.
Yeah. For me, it was the point of awakening to how the rest of the world is going to look at you. I was just another black face in the streets, and I was almost another dead black male.
Video shows Alford hitting the ground. Other video surveillance captures her screams.
When they smashed her into the pavement, they smashed her face in, you know, busted up her teeth. They drove her into the jail. They gave her no medical assistance. These white police officers stripping off all her clothes. She's saying, why are you taking off my clothes? Where are my pants? Where's my bra? And then she's completely naked. You know, she started to freak out. And that's when they sprayed her with all the pepper spray and mace.
Holiday says her initial charges were misdemeanors. But he says because the officers accused Alford of assaulting them, she was charged with two felonies. The bond was set high and she couldn't afford to get out of jail.
They falsely accused her of crimes she did not commit and left her in the jail for 33 days. How much is that worth? How much is a woman's dignity worth? How much is being falsely incarcerated worth? I don't know if you can put a dollar amount on that. That's going to be up to the jury.
What the fuck are you doing? Oh!
Yeah. He's coming down the trail, told him to stop. He hit the gas, came right at us.
I got you.
Please. Oh, fuck.
Hey.
Okay. Oh, what the fuck, man?
Sit down. Sit down on the ground.
Okay. I got you.
Oh. Please. I'm going to. I need you to sit down, buddy.
I'm sitting down. Okay. I'm sitting down.
Okay. All right. Oh. Sit down. Do not move. Okay. I'm gonna get you some stuff.
Oh, fuck.
Okay. I'll be right with you.
Yeah.
Not once, but four times across the face. The Sandoval County Sheriff's Office says that deputy is 70-year-old Fred Switzer. Let's rewind the video. You can see Switzer and another deputy restraining the teen in the back of a patrol car. The Sheriff's Office says he had just had an appearance at district court. There's no audio, and we blurred the teen's face, but it appears the teen starts to mouth off.
Walking by and doing what?
Well, you're making people nervous.
By walking by?
Yeah, they said you had your hands in your pockets.
How y'all doing today?
Good.
My name's Officer Bessie with Dane Police Department. The reason I'm pulling you over today, sir, is because you didn't signal 100 feet prior to your turn. You turned your turn signal on, but you didn't turn it on 100 feet prior.
Did I say he was going to do all this? I watched you turn me the whole time. I said, well, I don't know why this cop is behind me. I'm glad I got my video camera on too.
Well, I did signal.
You just needed a reason to pull me over.
I'm acknowledging that you did signal. Okay, I'm acknowledging that you signaled. You said do it 100 feet prior to your turn.
You just needed a reason to pull me over, sir. Okay. Is there a reason other than that? Because I did signal.
Yo, do you have your license, insurance, on you, sir?
I have everything.
Okay.
No disrespect. I don't have nothing against police officers, but all the shit that's going on now, that's some scary shit. To have a police officer just trailing you, and then you just pull me a reach because you said I didn't signal. What? You know how that looks? You drive without being in the cop car, right? You know how it is when the police pulling you over? You're like, I'm not doing nothing. Why is he, every move I make, why is he making it? I'm not doing nothing. Because I have a Michigan plate. Other than that, why was you trailing me?
Because you made direct eye contact with me and held on to it while I was passing you on Salem.
What?
Because you made direct eye contact with me and held on to it while I was passing you on Salem.
What? I made direct. I didn't even see you.
I'm not
going
to argue about it anymore, sir. If you want to keep talking about it, I'll just take your license back and give you a citation for the violation. We can take.
How you doing?
How you doing?
You see me come out of my driveway. I get
see
out.
License, registration,
and you
insurance?
Turn. Yes. But can I ask you though, like, what's the problem? What did I do wrong?
See your license, registration, insurance.
But what did I do wrong?
See your registration.
What did I do wrong?
I
have a cousin that's a Providence police officer for 23 years. But I want to know what's the problem. I'm tired of this shit. I came on my house to come to the store. My daughter's home sleep. Like, what's the problem, sir? Like, what's the problem? I'm not a gangster. I'm not a thug. What's the problem? Not a problem. What's the problem? I don't get why I got pulled over. I don't understand.
License. You have the insurance?
Insurance is right here, sir. Bill of sale, everything. This is my car. I own this car. I don't understand.
You have that. You can't have this. Well, obstructing your view.
What? Come on. Are you serious?
Yeah, I'm serious. Yeah, you can't have that there.
For my air fresheners.
Yeah,
I can't
have
this here. That is crazy. That's the reason why you pulled me over?
Yep.
You're bored. I can tell you're bored. Have a good day, man.
I'm bored.
Have a good day, sir.
Give me your ID, give me your information. So I'm getting out of work, right? You see, I work at Subway. And I'm coming to CVS. I'm walking across the street, and this guy gonna pull me over, and I'm walking. I'm not even fucking driving. What the fuck going on, man?
It's 24 right now.
Pleasant Grove, Alabama, man. 35127. What's the word, dude? You stopped and told me.
Hey, I'm gonna give you just a little
no,
bit
no. You stopped and told me.
I'm gonna give you just a little bit for you go to jail.
Don't walk like that. And I said, okay.
No, I said, get on across the road. You're about to come to a standstill.
And when you told me that, I was already at
then,
the gas station.
When I get right here, you walk back out in the edge of the road, come
that's
through
a
here.
Fucking sidewalk. Well, I'm supposed to walk on the grass? If it ain't no fucking sidewalk in fucking Alabama, what am I supposed to do about that? Why you stopped me? Tell me why you stopped me. Tell me why you stopped me.
I can come out and tell you anytime I want to.
You can do whatever the fuck you want to do.
This ain't a traffic stop.
I know, because I ain't fucking driving. I'm walking.
I was coming from a class in San Marcos, and I was going to work.
Man, take a seat back in the car, please. Take a seat back in your vehicle, please.
When he first pulled me over, I assumed he was pulling me over for speeding. I don't feel I was given enough time to comply.
I can ask him to stop you if you've already parked, yes. Yes, let me see your driver's license. All right, take a seat back in your car so we can close the door. Put your feet back in the car so I can close the door, please. Okay, ma'am, stand up for me, okay?
No. No, why are you coming, man?
Stop resisting.
Oh, my God.
Stop resisting.
Oh, my God.
Stop resisting. Stop resisting right now. Get out of the car.
I'm getting out. Let me get out. Do not touch me. Do not touch me.
Get out of the car now.
I swear. Ow. Oh, my God.
Put your hands behind your back.
Oh, my God.
Put your hands behind your back. You're under arrest. Put your hands behind your back.
Oh, my God. Why are you doing this to me?
Put your hands behind your back.
Yes, sir.
Put your hands behind your back.
Oh, my God. Are you serious?
Put your hands behind your back.
Oh, my God.
I'm about to taste you.
Leave me alone. Are you kidding me?
Put your hands behind your back right
now. Will you let me get down, please?
Get down.
I was pulled out of my vehicle and tossed around.
Oh my God, come to
the hands behind your back.
That's what I was doing.
I felt like I was kept from being allowed to put my hands behind my back.
Don't stand up.
I'm not trying to stand up. I'm trying to put my hands behind my back.
I was in disbelief. It was like an out-of-body experience. I feared for my life.
Get up.
Ow, bitch. Look at him. He's screaming like shit. He didn't even do anything.
Look at these.
What are you doing? That is a black police.
Walk.
Because you're full of bullshit.
We were aware of it as a department in terms of the actual incident involving the young lady and the use of force when it occurred, and it went through its normal channels, chain of review, and corrective action was taken because the chain determined that it wasn't handled in a manner that's consistent with what we'd expect, that the officer didn't do a very good job of de-escalating, and in fact ended up escalating it when he could have handled it differently. And so they took corrective action in terms of training and counseling at that time.
Hey, I didn't want to hit her, man.
Well, I know.
I was just trying to control her.
Yeah,
she's throwing at me, though.
Did she?
Oh, yeah.
It was all right here, too, right?
Most of it, yeah.
Because you're in circles, right?
Yeah, I mean, I saw her when I grabbed her out, finally got her out of the car. All I saw was going like this. I just said, boom.
Honestly, I do not recall swinging at him at all.
Move.
But do you still believe that there's racism out there?
Yes.
I had a desire to understand and to see what their perspective was and, you know, why do you feel this way? And ask a lot of questions. So I wanted to know why. I wanted to understand why.
Honestly, what they're trying to do is they're trying to wipe out the.
Why are so many people
afraid
of white
people? That's what I want to figure out, because I'm not a bad black person.
I can give you a really good idea of why it might be that way.
Why?
Violent tendencies.
To me, what was said, it was a racist comment.
But 99% of the time, when you hear about stuff like that, it is the black community that's being violent.
Mm-hmm.
That's why a lot of the white people are afraid, and I don't blame them.
It concerns me that a lot of people have, or just one officer, has this notion about a whole group of people, a whole community of people that he hasn't met, and he didn't know me, and he assumed that about me. So if he assumed that about me, who else can he assume this about?
I can tell you that those comments are not consistent with the expectations, the mindset. I think the mindset that we want of our folks, or anybody in law enforcement, anybody in a position of authority, we've actually ordered an investigation into that.
I've become afraid of the people who were supposed to protect me. If people are held accountable to their actions, then I feel like maybe this wouldn't be happening.
I'm an immigrant, and I'm a person that takes race relations very seriously, that takes the way that we conduct ourselves very seriously. And we're going to do some work to do two things. One, take a look at the officer with the comments and that conversation, which is just pretty offensive to me, that there's people in this world that think that way. But the second piece is also to make sure that the actions that we took in terms of the initial incident in the parking lot, to make sure that that corrective action worked, and so we're going to audit that officer's work as well.
It has been a year, and my desire, regardless of what has happened to me, is to continue to strive to be a better person. Will I forget? No, ma'am. Not at all. But I want to be able to live my life. So for me, will I get better? God's will, yes ma'am, I will. We'll be okay.